Hey everybody, welcome to the Honey Badger Art Stream number 6, which we're going to be renaming Doge of Venice from this point on. So, but this time we'll just keep the Honey Badger Art Stream. And, what?
Which we're going to be renaming Doge of Venice.
Oh, crap. If any of you guys are listening, what the... So, that was me. Hold
on. But this time we'll just...
Sorry about that. I was getting feedback. All right. Well, anyway, I'm Brian, and I'm joined by the other artists that are contributors to Honey Badger Radio. This is the biggest stream yet. I have Ku. Hey, Ku, how's it going? Ku is working on his Monster Girls webcomic, because he is a workaholic when it comes to the webcomic, it seems. We have Eduardo, who is... Oh, that looks awesome. Is that that's for the Sargon contest?
I'm going to make a lot of final faces just to see what comes up from it.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That looks good. I like that. We have Daniel, who's been coming on the last few streams. He's just sort of getting started right now.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out my pencil settings. So, hello, everyone.
Hello.
And we have Corvus, who is making a... What was it? You were doing a Dark Souls thing?
I was playing Dark Souls, so I got inspired to do some Dark Souls character with Badger-chan.
So you're making a Dark Souls Badger-chan. Mm-hmm. I love it. And me. And so we're going to... just sort of dick around and make some art and talk about stuff. I was just going to say, those of you guys who were in the chat, there were a couple of meme or concepts that were suggested that we might like fool around with or try to like execute. One was offered by Allison. She liked the meme, men should help women out the door. So the try to come up with an image that would best execute that in the funniest way possible. Men should help women out the door. And the other was apparently Sargon of Akkad is doing a contest where he's asking artists to make a new and interesting way of executing the Sargon character, his online persona. So that's what... Eduardo's doing right now. Let me go back to it. Or at least that's what it looks like you're doing.
Yeah, for now.
Yeah, so if you guys have any ideas on either of those things, you know, go ahead and throw them in there, and if we're feeling inspired, we'll mess around with it. I think that in the meantime, I'm just gonna doodle, and maybe we can talk about, well, let's see what the chat is saying right now. Let's see. One in the chat hardly. At the shit post to make everyone feel more comfortable. Mm-hmm. Hulk Hogan. Somebody says that Eduardo's image looks like Hulk Hogan. Well, you kind of see that. I think maybe it's like a bit of Hulk Hogan as the ancient Akkadian king.
That movie, that was...
It would be awesome, brother.
Yeah.
So Douglas, and I know I've seen people talking about this already. I guess we should just may as well address the elephant in the room. Everyone's talking about Ghost in the Shell.
Yeah.
And the first image was leaked of Scarlett Johansson as the title character. Is there reason for concern? I don't know. because we knew that she was going to be cast to play this character for so long, it just doesn't surprise me that I think it's just going to be a shit movie, personally, but what are you guys' thoughts on that? Anybody?
I don't really care. It just just seems like it's always going to be whitewashed by Hollywood anyways, so might as well just let her see if she can get the character right or not.
Yeah.
I think the anime was okay.
I have seen that. Apparently they try to use computers to make the characters Japanese.
Oh, yeah, that one.
They did, or they're going to?
No, they try it.
They try.
That's hilarious. It's gonna maybe end up a little bit like the Wachowskis thing with their what was that movie? Where they tried to Asia-fy everybody.
Cloud Atlas.
Yeah, that's the one.
I wonder if the SJWs will be calling out social cultural appropriation.
I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like, it just does. I was never. I didn't ever really love Ghost in the Shell. I like Masamune Shirow as an artist a great deal, and I was pretty into things like in the comic version of Appleseed and Dominion Tank Police.
Oh yeah, Dominion Tank Police was my favorite.
What was that?
Dominion Tank Police was my favorite.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
I think it's just that. I don't know. I just didn't really care that much. So about Ghost in the Shell, and I know that, and there were like different versions. Like, you know, Standalone Complex was one that I liked a lot, and then but then there was the original one, and I think they made like one or two other ones more recently. When I think that basically, if Hollywood says we want to make an adaptation of this anime. There to assume that there's a chance that it could be good is to fool yourself, because it has not. They have yet to get it right. Unless, wait, let me think. Is there a case where they took an anime and got it right?
I like it. Like, but this one with Tom Cruise. What was the name?
What was that?
There is one with Tom Cruise that they made also based in the manga. But I can remember in English at least.
I mean, like, I think the closest thing might have been when the Wachowski did Speed Racer, but still not really an awesome movie. So, I'm quite forgettable. Speed Racer was visually cool, but not especially good. I don't know. I just don't like. Whenever when I heard a while back, many years ago, they were talking about making a Robotech or Macross movie.
Yeah, totally.
And when I heard that, like, a lot of people I knew got really excited, and I was like, why? They're just gonna screw it up. Nobody wants to watch that. Nobody wants to watch. That if it's going to be made by a studio that is largely out of touch with it, firstly. And secondly, I think that when you try to translate something from anime into live action, you're just running into limitations right off the bat. Because one of the things that makes anime appealing is it has a very iconic or specific sort of visual style. And you're eliminating the visual style, and you're basically putting in real people. I don't know that it works. Even when Japan makes live-action movies of their animes, they don't often turn out very good. I mean, Who here saw Devilman? I think they made a live-action of Devilman. They made a live-action of Cutie Honey. They made a live-action of Captain Harlock. They made
Gantz.
A live-action... What was that?
Gantz. They did Gantz trilogy movie.
Yeah, they did... Kashern, they did Tekkaman or Technoman, I believe. They did They've done tons, and many of them are awful. They did Yamato, space battleship Yamato. They did G-Force. Oh my god, G-Force was so bad. It was so boring.
They did Rurouni Kenshin as well.
They did Rurouni Kenshin, yes. So, I don't know. I think that what would be better if they just did a very, very high quality animated of the movie they were trying to adapt. I think that will do better. And actually,
bit of series now where they got like TV show type series in which they got, and they're freaking great. So there's no big worry about that.
Yeah.
But yeah. I mean, watching the first Ghost in the Shell, the one that everybody likes to praise and talk about, it's a phenomenal film in the first place. So if they're just trying to recreate that, yeah, it's going to be crap because you can't get as expressive and as just out there with the ideas in live action as you can in animation.
Yeah. Although I kind of wish that the original Ghost in the Shell film, maybe it's because it's I know why I feel this way. I wish it looked more like Masamune Shirow's art style. Because I like his art style a lot, that's why.
There is a live action series for Robotech made in South America.
Really?
Yeah, they did. Three chapters, and they were more or less okay.
There you go. A live action Ghost in the Shell?
No, Robotech.
Oh, Robotech. Three chapters.
But I think with Robotech it may be easier because they always in macros they always try to do. Obviously, it's not like real life, but they try to do more real things.
Well, I don't know. Sorry, I'm like working on my thing. Let's see what the chats guys are saying. The live action Dragon Ball was amazing.
cried when they saw that movie.
Oh, wow.
What was that?
I said I actually know somebody who cried when they saw that movie. He was such a big DBZ fan.
You know, but what? Isn't that one of those things where you could see the trailer and be like, "That looks like shit. I'm not watching that." I mean, like, how is this even? Like, how do you, you know? I'll give it a shot. Doesn't look too bad. Like, who does that? I'm sure that somebody does.
People go to see Transformers, so...
Yeah!
Yeah, that's true.
And they keep going to see Transformers. Like, they keep... Like, they think this time he'll get it right. He's just finding his footing. You know? It's like, no. That ship has sailed. But actually, I think another thing about, specifically with Transformers, and maybe this is the same thing they're trying to do when they do other adaptations like this, they're hoping that instead of hold on to or maintain the audience that loved the original source material, they're trying to create a new generation of fans. So they, you know, completely change the designs. They make it so. I mean, it's been so long since Transformers was as big as it was back in Generation 1 that to try to like maintain that audience might be more work for them than it's worth, and it might be easier for them to try to like get a new audience, a younger audience. So that's, I think, what, you know, the Michael Bay Transformers is, even though it is using nostalgia to sell Transformers. But I don't know. I could be completely wrong on that. But I think that's where it went, because it's still really popular, despite the fact that it doesn't deserve to be.
Who's the singer? They recommissioned the original singer of You Got the Touch, the Hype It Up.
What was that? You're kind of low.
Oh, am I? Oh, sorry. I said they recommissioned the old singer of You Got the Touch. I can't remember his name.
Stan Bush.
Yes, that's right, Stan Bush. Yeah, they recommissioned him to do the movie version, didn't they?
Oh, I don't know.
Did the first one. Yeah, to hype it up for nostalgia purposes.
Oh God, why?
It was as bad as you could probably imagine it would be.
Oh my God. Yeah, Corvus, is there a way for you to turn up the gain on your microphone at all?
Sure, I can have a look.
Yeah, okay, because look, the chat's saying you're pretty low.
Ah.
Okay. Let's see here. I'm trying to make an Irma Gerd face on this badger. But I don't know if it looks appropriate. There's a big rumor about what? Live action Pokemon film?
Oh yeah, I watched the news yesterday, I think, or when was it that they mentioned it?
So they're making a live action Pokemon.
I think there's an idea.
Okay. All right, sounds good.
I think Lionsgate also has the rights for a Naruto movie. I read that somewhere, I'm sure.
Yeah, Lionsgate does. They do anything. They don't care. They really do. Samuel Lee, I see you. I prefer Terraformers. Terraformars. It's an anime. Recently aired its second season. Should watch it. Good action series.
Read the comic.
Read the comic?
The anime for Terraformars is one of the most absolute shits I have ever seen, but the comic is amazing.
Oh, okay. So it's one of those read the manga type of things. Arched eyebrows, yeah, good idea. Like up here. I don't know. Like that. Or should I? Like here, I'll make a little doodle up here. These are the eyes. Should they be like high up? Or should it arch this way? Or like more like that? I don't know. Is that? What program are you using for the badger sketch? I'm using manga studio slash, I think they call it Clip Studio in other places. That's also the same program that Ku is using. And I don't know if
How's my sound now? Is it better?
Oh yeah, that sounds good.
Awesome.
Yeah. And Eduardo and Corvus. No, Eduardo's using Photoshop CS6, so you can see it, and it looks awesome. And Corvus is using Adobe Photoshop CC or Creative Cloud, right?
Yes.
And Daniel is using a program called, I forget, what's the name of it again?
It's called ArtRage.
ArtRage. And yeah. Is that like a...
It was a free program that came with my Bamboo, yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you normally use Sketch Pro, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but the problem is that Sketch Pro won't...
It doesn't like to...
Yeah, it doesn't work on
screen. Hangouts. Yeah.
So it won't show up. Kuhn's using Clip Studio KEX, and I'm using Manga Studio EX, but it's basically the same thing. Krita is good too, although I wasn't able to share that one when I tried for whatever reason. It wouldn't allow me to do that. Maybe I'm gonna look up a picture of the Ermengarde girl so I can try to get a better idea here. Huh. How much do you plan to get done with this live stream? Well, I don't know. Maybe I'll finish the Ermengarde Badger and then see where everyone else is at. It's fucking crazy. Alright, let's try make a copy of this. Copy of that layer. And then over here. When you guys needed to get drawing, what do you guys find is the best way to get yourself motivated and ready to go? Or do you just sort of let things happen, like when I don't know, whenever they do, like
music? Music.
Music. Anybody else?
I usually just try to let it flow and just get something on the page and then see where it goes from there. Unless I know exactly what I'm doing.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, music is good. Sometimes I'll watch other people do an art stream. And that will get me motivated too, especially like some people that I admire. Even just looking for references can be inspiring.
I usually look at pictures and draw just loads of crappy sketch art until I find something that I think is fairly okay.
Well, like crappy sketch art?
Yeah, just like loads of quick line stick figures until I find something I enjoy and then work from that. Kind of hitting this.
Yes, yes. So you said you're playing Dark Souls right now?
Yeah.
A 3, right? I mean obviously it's 3.
Yeah.
Well, some people are just. I just got Dark Souls 1. I think it's. It just came out. How are you liking it?
It's pretty good. I've had so much trouble with crashes though. It doesn't seem to like me.
Really?
Yeah, my friends. They seem to be working on it pretty well, but crashes quite frequently for me. And when that's not happening, my controller seems to be dying out. But besides that, it's an amazing game. I think it's definitely worth it.
All right. And what platform are you playing it on?
Oh, Steam.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Are you pretty far? I haven't really.
I've gotten to the like hunter boss. I'm not gonna spoil it actually, because some people might not want that to be spoiled. But I'll sort of give a brief description. It's like a boss with you walk into a room and there's like bosses killing each other.
Oh yeah, okay. I think I've seen that in like a trailer or something.
Yeah, I don't want to give too much away though.
Yeah, that's fine. When you said Hunter Boss, I thought, oh shit, are they like connecting it to Bloodborne in some way? Because I could see them doing that without telling anybody.
I haven't played Bloodborne, actually.
Oh, well, that was another thing I was going to say, is I have the PS4 version. I believe Bloodborne was a PS4 exclusive.
Yeah.
But essentially, it's Demon's Souls with... and Dark Souls, but it's, you know, set in a Victorian setting, and there's some pretty interesting gameplay differences between the two, and it's also very Lovecraftian, but yeah. I really dig it.
They had some, I think I said it was just kind of like a combination between Dark Souls 1 and Bloodborne.
A combination between Dark Souls 1 and 2?
No, 1 and Bloodborne.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I would suspect. I would have suspected that. But yeah, I've been playing the PS4 version of Dark Souls 3.
How's that like?
I haven't had any crashes yet, but again, to be fair, I'm not very far into it. Hold on a second, I'll be right back. I gotta get the door.
So, how much are you enjoying the game?
Pretty well, actually. you get some quite intense combat, because they sped up the combat system since the second game. It's a lot faster, and you notice that immediately when you first get onto it. Like there's an initial boss that you fight, and he's surprisingly quick. But yeah, I think it's mainly for you to get used to the controls on the and the pace of the new version. And it does, it helps.
Okay. Yeah. Are you like watching any of the YouTubers that like to do the whole lore or tips and tricks and stuff?
No. I haven't really seen much of the lore.
No?
Nah.
Don't want to spoil too much for yourself?
Yeah, pretty much. I enjoy like playing games for the game. Rather than spoil it with people telling me how the game is.
I'm back.
Welcome back.
Yeah. Let's see. Was it your weed man? No, it's my nephew. That doesn't mean he's not a weed man, though. His spare time. Okay. Yeah, we'll leave it at that. Let's try to do some more finalized lines. All right, so yeah, anyway. Back on the Dark Souls 3. I did watch a, well, I don't know, I've always loved that series, so. But did you see the article somebody wrote not too long ago about how Dark Souls should have an easy mode? And the problem with, what is it, the problem with playing to win?
No, but I see where this is going.
It triggers it.
They should make a Dark Souls safe bubble as well, so no enemies can hurt you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There was a girl, I think she was a feminist, who made a tweet. Someone apparently did a mod to play, I think it was Dragon Age, without the fights. You don't have to fight. So she said, oh, I can play now because I don't want to fight.
Oh my god. What game was it?
I think it was Dragon Age, but I am not sure.
Jesus, these people. I don't want to fight in this game about fighting.
That's why I need Sarkeesian doesn't understand that playing Angry Birds is not the same as playing something like Dark Souls.
Yeah, I want to see somebody make a mod for Mortal Kombat without any combat. That's what I think.
That would be kind of funny.
Yeah, the only thing you can do is friendships on each other.
Yeah.
But they're done by pressing like any button because we don't want to make it too hard to do them. So.
Well, you could kind of say that Undertale is a little bit like that.
Yeah, I know. I've never played Undertale. I just don't play games on Steam much.
Yeah, but I mean, with Undertale, it's mostly about defense, right? Having to move that little heart around so that it doesn't get hit too much.
I've seen the game be played, but I've never actually played it myself. It did look interesting, though.
Well, a lot of people seem to enjoy themselves with it.
Yeah.
Well, they do. I heard that Undertale was a game that you could play, and maybe I'm thinking about something else, but isn't that the one that you could play and kill everyone, or you can play and completely kill absolutely no one?
Yeah.
So you can do it either all violent or completely non-violent?
Yeah.
If you choose? Okay.
People really love to do the non-violent route because it's a better story.
Hmm. The moment you found out. Okay, chat. Is Undertale an SJW game? Or is it just a good game that the SJWs are trying to claim is an SJW game? Because they do that all the time. They don't make something. Something comes out. It might have like something that they like in it. And then they say, oh yeah, this is coming from the right play. This is coming from the correct camp. These people are on the right side of history. Is that an example of that or not? I'm just curious.
I'm surprised that they haven't tried to do that with the Knights of Azur game.
Knights of what?
Knights of Azur is a game that came out this month, and the protagonists are a couple of lesbians. And the game is good. I have completed and it's good, but I have not seen anyone, almost anyone, saying anything about it.
Well. There's a lot of games that I think that they didn't notice they ought to. I'm playing Senran Kagura Estival Versus, and I don't know of a game that's a better, more feminist title than that. It has an all female cast. And there are varying body types, and there are no men. It passes the Bechdel test like right off the bat. You know, it's got everything that they want. It's sex positive. It's
We should create an opposite vegetal test.
Oh, an opposite to Estable versus?
No, a vegetal test in opposite.
Oh, yes.
Like, how many men are in Dithro Life Extreme Volleyball?
Well, I think Zach might be in that game. That's about it.
It doesn't pass the test.
No, it does not. It does not pass the Badger test. I don't know what we even call it. But yeah, I mean, it passes the Bechdel test. There's, you know, like I said, there's different kinds of, there's a lot of, like, sort of lesbian relationships in there, and, you know, queer love interests.
Yeah, but if men have to eat, then that's more good.
What was that?
That if men have to eat, that's not good.
No. Let's see here. I kind of like the pencil. I'm kind of liking this pencil tool. Let's see what the chat is saying. What?
Oh, that's just a great face.
Made by men, acted by men, produced and directed by men, for men. Men. All the action is in the chat. Lords of Shite. Undertale was meh. Airsoft first person shooter. Actually, I would play something like that, or like a paint. Don't they make paintball FPSs or something like that? Doctor Strange, what was that?
I was going to say paintball FPS.
Oh, is that actually what it's called?
No, I was asking it as a question.
Oh, yeah.
I'd never heard of it. Heard that before.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if they do, but why wouldn't they? I think that'd be a good idea. So something to think about. Maybe they do. Maybe somebody made a mod for something else.
It sounds like it could be a Counter-Strike mod.
Yeah. What doesn't? Doctor Strange. Did you guys see it? What do you think of the trailer?
I haven't seen it, and I haven't seen the trailer yet either.
It's not that bad. It's, I like the fact that it's, like, got the crazy Inception thing going on. That helps it.
Yeah, I somebody said to me that they didn't like it because they thought it was just borrowing from a bunch of other stuff, and they mentioned Inception. But I don't know that that's exact. I mean, I could see how it looks like that at first glance, but I don't think that that's actually what it's doing. If you look at the effect, it's doing this kaleidoscopic thing with 3D models. Whereas Inception is literally folding the folding cities in half.
Yeah, because they got like three cities converging on itself, right?
It's kind of like the scene where, I don't know who it was, but they're like walking down a hallway and all this stuff is like becoming distorted and it's like unfolding and opening up. But it actually looks like a kaleidoscope, like you're looking at multiple facets as it's doing that. And then when that happens with the city, it's the same thing. I think it's the same kind of effect. So I'm not sure that it's just a straight-up rip of Inception. Plus, Doctor Strange as a concept is way older. So, he's from like the 1960s. And if you read those books, you could see that they were trippy as fuck. So, I remember reading them and going, what the hell is happening in this book? what was Steve Ditko on when he was making this artwork?
What I love. It's that it's Steve Ditko, the guy that helped create Spider-Man, and yet he's so out there. And he's so anti-drug as well, which is crazy.
So weird. That's like Hieronymus Bosch, who was like, you know, really religious and, you know, like a purist in a lot of ways, but his art was like so...
Messed up.
Yeah. You have like people getting raped by giant praying mantises and shit. guys getting sodomized with flutes. And then he'd be like, yeah, sodomy's bad. let's see what the chat is saying about Doctor Strange. What do you guys think?
I wish I got a bit better look at what Madison Mars, or whatever his name is, what his the look of, he's got, which they got him going with.
Who's Madison Mars?
Or the guy who was playing Hannibal in the TV show.
Mads Mikkelsen.
Mads Mikkelsen. That's
okay. Mikkelsen. Yeah. What? He is in the movie, but what? What? Who is he playing?
Yeah, I have no idea.
They didn't show him in the trailer, though, did they?
Yeah, they did. Wait. He was the guy that was walking along the little thing, and all like the big gears and
everything
and things
becoming
were
distorted,
moving around.
Well, if I had to guess, when it comes to Doctor Strange's enemies and stuff, Baron Mordo, we already know, is being played by the other guy.
Yeah.
Whose name I'm not even going to attempt to pronounce right now. And then the other one, the really big one, is Dormammu. So, but Dormammu doesn't look like that. He's got like a flaming head. But yeah. Maybe it'll happen by the end, or maybe he's taking on some form. I don't know. I would guess that it would be a good idea to have Mads play Dormammu, because I think he could do it.
Mm-hmm.
Good question is, why is James Hong not the Ancient One? I don't know.
Because they got Tilda Swinton doing it.
Tilda Swinton because vagina. Yeah. Or... you know.
Well, that, and she's also a very strange-looking person.
She is. I agree. Yeah, Tilda Swinton is the Ancient One. I don't know. I mean, I'm okay with it because I'm expecting that as, you know, this stuff sort of continues on. As we make more of these movies and they make more money, there's going to be more diversity quotas and shit like that. So
yeah, but I mean, look, she's like a fantastic actor, and with the Ancient One, it could be just like a play of illusion, right?
Mm-hmm.
So who knows?
Yeah. Well, what about the speaking of the Marvel stuff, there was an article written about Iron Fist, and because that's like one of the shows coming out pretty soon, and they were disappointed that he was a white man. I don't know if you
guys have white man in the comics.
He is a white man in the comics, yes. And it's weird because they're in a weird double bind anyway, because if Iron Fist is played by a white man, which is faithful to the comics, then it's racist because Iron Fist should be Asian, I guess, is what they're saying, because he's been trained in martial arts. But if you cast an Asian man to play Iron Fist because martial arts, it's racist because it's a stereotype of Asians knowing martial arts. So... you kind of like, damned if you do, damned if you don't. This is why you have to just ignore those people. I don't know.
Yeah, so. You know, even though Hollywood has a history of white people playing all types of races and everything else. It's nice that they are putting in a little bit of diversity, but seriously, I would rather have good actors playing a diverse character than a diverse, you know, minority, whatever it is, being a bad actor.
Yeah. No, that was another thing that, like, going back to the Ghost in the Shell, not that I think that Scarlett Johansson is a good actor, but I think that there is a bit of a challenge kind of baked into casting an Asian actress to play Scarlett Johansson, because they'd have to, or to play the Ghost in the Shell character, because they'd have to find someone who was talented, spoke English well, and would, you know, be really good. I mean, I know that a lot of people are looking at the lady who was in Pacific Rim, but I'm not sure that she would be a really great actress, though. I mean, her performance in Pacific Rim was okay, but it wasn't, like, anything to write home about. So, and again, I'm not saying that Scarlett Johansson is worthy of a, you know, she's going to be taking home any Oscars, but I just wonder about that, you know. I think there's another challenge there. Plus, and I'm not taking sides here, I'm just trying to, like, rationalize these decisions. When you adapt something like Ghost in the Shell, which I don't know, I would argue does not have, like, massive mainstream appeal. You need to, like, have something to create box office draw. Otherwise, people, they're not going to watch it. And it may not make a lot of money. And it may get, like, cult classic status, but my guess is that if they do this, they're going to spend a lot of money on it. And they're not going to be able to say, you know, oh, well, we have, like, this great director, because sometimes you can use a director to do it. Like, James Cameron had been for the longest time talking about making an adaptation of Alita: Battle Angel. It never happened, and, you know, when he's asked about it, he still says, oh, no, I'm going to do it, but I'm like, no, you're not going to. But if he had done it, he could have casted whoever he wanted, because people would have watched it because it's James Cameron.
Yeah. But I think Ghost in the Shell, I think they're playing up the fact that it's going to be probably an action movie, and that's one of the main reasons probably why they cast Scarlett Johansson, is because she's done so much action.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we'll just have to wait and see.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think that when you have the wrong people on a project, it's kind of doomed. And
yeah,
it is likely that it's going to probably be like some Luc Besson, fucking Aeon Flux, you know.
Well, it is being done by a bunch of French people.
Is it?
It's like telling the people that the movie is going to be bad beforehand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like I was looking through the IMDb page, and most of the actors and stuff, and there's a lot of French names.
Oh, yeah?
Have you seen, this was like a year or 2 years ago, they're going to do an Akira movie too. The director of the movie said in an interview that he can do the movie better than the creator of Akira.
Wow.
Ooh. That's a big statement.
So that's that the movie is going to be bad.
Yeah. Again, you know, I can understand why people would want an Akira movie. I can understand it. But do you really, considering what you are risking, like, do you really want that after all the shit that we've gotten? Or, like, you know, Dragon Ball Evolution and, I don't know, the Tekken movie and King of Fighters movie and Dead or Alive and all these other things that were adapted by people who don't know anything about the product that they're trying to adapt.
The Tekken movie was bad, but the characterization was very good.
Yeah. I don't know. I never, I couldn't finish it. I love Tekken, but yeah, as a game.
But if you look at the actors, they look like the characters.
They do. I won't disagree with that.
I like what Darren Aronofsky did with his movie, the really dark one. What the heck is it called?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, the one where everybody shoots up with heroin. Anyways, what he did was he took the anime Perfect Blue, he bought the rights to it, but then he took like scenes and shots and everything that he found very interesting visually about that movie and put it into his. And that's how, that was like a good way of adapting, is because it's not taking away from the anime, and it's also making something which he's proud of that's he's more creative with.
The movie where everyone's shooting up, you don't happen to be talking about Requiem for a Dream.
Yeah,
you?
That one.
And he used Perfect Blue.
He was using Perfect Blue. He was using the visuals and some of the compositions and color themes from Perfect Blue in Requiem for a Dream.
That's interesting. I did not know that.
Yeah.
I thought that was just the guy who made Black Swan. That was I was doing that with Requiem for a Dream, or with Perfect Blue. Because those are almost, they seem very similar to me.
Mm-hmm.
I think Aronofsky also wanted to make a Batman vs. Superman movie. Not sure about that.
He wanted to make a Batman movie.
Yeah.
Aaron Aronofsky?
Yeah. And he even casted Christian Bale, I think.
Was that before or after Nolan did it?
Yeah.
It was before Nolan did it. When they were trying to reboot Batman, they were testing out directors, and they decided to go with Nolan over Aronofsky.
Oh.
Which is a good idea, which was, you know, I mean, in hindsight, very good idea. But I think Aronofsky could have also pulled off a really cool Batman.
Yeah, I think Aronofsky could have done a good Batman movie.
He also wanted to make the Robocop remake, doesn't he?
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either about that one.
I don't think you should remake RoboCop. That's sacrilege. RoboCop is so good.
If you decided to do like a sequel, that would probably be better.
They've already done two sequels, but
yeah, but you can scrap those because they were shitty movies, right?
Yeah. Did you know that Frank Miller wrote them?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just throwing it out there for those of you guys.
He made a comic.
He made a RoboCop comic?
Yeah. I think it was an adaptation of the movie, or right? I'm not sure if it was the movie that was adapted from the comic, or if the comic was adapted from the movie.
I remember people thought RoboCop when the movie was being released. It's just me showing how old I am. People were sure that it was an adaptation of a comic book, but it wasn't. It just sort of felt like a comic book in many ways. But the Verhoeven wanted to look at various themes of, you know, male disposability, men as people as property, of the corporations, the combination of government and capitalism, like crony capitalism, basically, and all this other stuff. Themes of resurrection, of determinism, and, you know, wrapped it up in this kind of funny and fun, super violent movie called RoboCop. and a lot of people don't get all those themes. But Verhoeven was always good at doing that. He did it for Starship Troopers too, while it wasn't like a perfect adaptation of the books, probably not even close. It was actually really good on its own, though. Would you like to know more?
That's a good reference.
The fourth movie for Starship Troopers is more close to the books.
Oh, really?
It's an animated 3D movie, and they show the power armor.
And it's actually part of the film canon as well?
Yep.
3D anime. Is that where Casper Van Dien is getting his work now? I don't know who that is. He played Rico in the original.
He's helping out Screen Junkies with a few of their short films and stuff now, too.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. The internet, internet saves lives.
Yeah.
It gives people jobs. That's huge.
Because, yeah, I mean, I always liked Casper Van Dien. I thought he was, his role in Starship Troopers was really good, and that he should have got more work from it.
Yeah, I think he may have, what happened with Casper Van Dien, I'm pretty sure, is probably, drugs and alcohol and stuff.
Yeah.
It's like what happened to Brendan Fraser. Because everyone liked Brendan Fraser, and then he started, fucking up, basically. And, Lindsay Lohan, which we all know, she was a train wreck. A few other people. I think Sean William Scott, who I also liked. He was in American Pie.
Played Stifler. But Sean William Scott now is, he stopped with his whole partying thing and all that stuff.
Yeah, but it might be too late for his career, though.
Yeah. Suppose.
It might be. I mean, I don't know. Maybe he'll do soaps. They're always looking for talent.
Yeah, and he's always typecast now as the Stifler type character. Just the rude, crude, I'm going to be a big bully type person.
Michael Biehn. Michael Biehn is still good. I mean, I don't know did that happen to him? Because I know he was doing some Robert Rodriguez stuff for a while, even though Robert Rodriguez hasn't been doing anything. I was showing my girlfriend who had never seen Aliens.
Oh my God, really?
And I showed her RoboCop as well. And she liked those. Although when I tried to show her Planet Terror, she hasn't been able to get through it yet, so... but yeah, hopefully she will before too much longer. Now, what was that you were saying about? Were you groaning about the aliens thing? I know it's
really sad. Oh, like, yeah, it's strange.
Well, she's a bit young. It just sort of passed under her radar.
So my partner hasn't seen Star Wars.
Yeah, she's only seen one Star Wars movie, I think. I'm not in a huge hurry to show her those, though, but we'll get to it. Just have to, I have to build myself up to be like, okay, we're going to watch The Phantom Menace, you know? Because you got to, see it all. I think that you should just watch them all in order.
Now, bite down and grit your teeth, because this is going to be painful.
Yeah, it's going to be painful. Please don't judge the whole series based on this movie, you know? We just gotta establish. I guess you don't have to, and I could just give you the short version. But I'm a bit upset.
You know what? Just show her the Red Letter Media videos.
Oh, the guy who was
the Mr. Plinkett. Because he basically goes over the entire movie, anyways.
Yeah. Right. Michael Biehn became an alcoholic. You can find out. Oh, I didn't know that. I'd like to see Biehn. I like him. I liked him in, yes, he was in Planet Terror. I also liked him in The Rock. Actually, I've got to tell you, The Rock is, you can hate Michael Bay. I get it. You know, he ruined Transformers, and he doesn't make great movies these days. But The Rock is a good movie. I like that movie. As well as Bad Boys. I mean, Bad Boys is pretty good too. And those are Michael Bay movies. So, but The Rock is good. And fight me if you disagree. That's fine.
The Rock is the one with Sean Connery.
Yes, yeah. The one with Sean Connery.
The Luge is always Wayne about that at best.
What was that?
Luge is always Wayne about that at best.
Yes, right. Winners go home and fuck the prom queen.
That's the best line of that movie.
Yeah, but that movie's got great lines, though, from beginning to end.
He was good in Highlander, actually, Sean Connery.
Mm-hmm. Sean Connery?
Yeah.
Oh, he's Sean Connery's pretty good in everything. That's you know, true, Sean actually. Connery is the only guy... Well, no, he's not the only guy. He's one of those actors that literally just plays himself in every movie. and no one questions it. You know, and I know that there's, like, this has been done... But, like, literally, every movie he's in, it doesn't matter where he's from, where the character is supposed to be from, or what the character's nationality is supposed to be, he's now a Scottish guy named Sean Connery. For the movie. You know, when he... like, that just what he is, you know?
And he's a very masculine man.
Somebody wrote, Sean Connery is such a misogynist, though. No, he was actually... He's gynocentric, because he said, sometimes an open hand is better than a clenched fist. You know, when it comes to women, he'd mm-hmm. rather slap them than punch them. So he's already being nice.
And that's the era in which he grew up in, right? Where occasionally a woman needed to be slapped to stop being hysterical.
Yeah. You know what?
In which, I mean, a lot of my mom would never have taken that shit, but that's the era in which he grew up in. And... It's really hard to get away from that when you've really decided to put that into your personality.
Sean Connery's badass. But he can slap women and still get laid. I admire that.
You think about it, the kid who did Kingsman... He has that type of a character, too.
In the movie, or... Yeah, sure.
Yeah, in the movie.
Well, the guy who made... is it Mark Miller? Mark Millar? The director, not the...
Vaughn, right?
Yeah. I think that he's of that attitude where he's like, you know, I don't care if this seems misogynistic. This is the movie I want to make, you know, so...
Mm-hmm.
Slap across the face is the best cure for hysterics. Your shoulder into it. Colin Firth is the man. Yes. I like the Colin Firth. And I think that's good. Hermagerd. Wait. That butt scene.
Oh, yeah. That lady had a great ass.
Who?
The lady from Kingsman at the very end. The Swedish diplomat or whatever she was.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't... you know what? Are there two versions? Because the one I saw it in the theater... and that was the only time I saw it. Is there, like, another version? Because I keep hearing about how some are, like, I don't know, like, NC-17.
Yeah, I think there is. I think the U.S. and a couple of other countries had a problem with that, so that they switched it up a bit. But yeah. I think in, like, the video release and all that stuff, they kept the... ass shot into it, because I only seen it like that, and that was off of Netflix. But I'm also Canadian, right? sometimes we get more sexualized stuff than the U.S.
That's right.
Trudeau allows it?
What's that?
The Trudeau allows it.
If Trudeau allows it, yes.
Yeah. Well, he is French. And the French seem to like their sexuality, so I think we're okay in that factor.
I don't know what Trudeau does.
He seems pretty dedicated to the feminist cause.
Yeah.
Trudeau has thrown away his humanity many, many years ago. So, I don't know. You guys can... You might be fucked, is all I'm saying. I think the only Lauren Southern can save you now.
You know what? I will say this. I think he is better than the guy which we had before.
Mm-hmm.
Because Harper, yeah. Even though he wasn't a big player on the world stage, the way he ran his government and everything was kind of iron-fisted, and it was kind of driving down our economy and our way of being Canadian, because it felt like that we were becoming more aggressive for absolutely no reason.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Where you guys are at, if I can, I'm going to click on each person. Corvus, would you zoom out? I want to see this Dark Souls Badger Chan. Oh, yeah. I like that. Are you going to do white, like red and white, the colors?
Yeah.
Cool. And the green hair, I love it. Cool. I wonder how much poise she has. what's her poise?
Or 0.1. Breaks instantly.
Daniel, you're animating something?
I am now animating something.
Play that for me. I want to see that.
Just
what do you? What is it for? I like the expression there. Is that a needle?
That looks like Anita.
Yeah, a little bit. It's a feminist, so... Yeah,
that Sorry, saga reminds me of Zeus from the old, Disney cartoon of, Hercules.
One?
Hercules.
Oh, okay, yeah. So, yeah. She's just, like... It's kind of cutting between a few different shots here, so...
Mm-hmm.
Just doing a little head movement right now.
That's an eye roll.
An eye roll, yeah.
Yeah, it's like men. All right.
And it's for the animation I'm working on for you guys.
Yeah, awesome. Can't wait. Yeah, we got some really talented
people
helping out. Yeah, doing animations. So, okay. And so, Eduardo, you're doing the Sargon. I like that one that's got a, like, smirking.
I'm making many versions of Sargon.
Are you trying to, like, come up with just one to be the image you're going to submit, or are you just sort of playing around with different expressions?
Just playing around with some expressions and hair shapes.
Wait, what's that? Yeah, Cassie J. Is Cassie J Canadian? I thought that she was American for some reason. I guess I can send the push link to Brian through the Patreon messenger. All right. So yeah, no, these look great. What's this one you're doing right now? Is that another expression?
What?
This new Sargon you're drawing, you just started.
Oh yeah. It's
Yeah.
It's like Santa Claus. Like the real Santa
Claus. Koo, you're doing some Monster Girl stuff, but those are JoJo poses. I know that's the Caesar. What's the other one? I want to see. You get a chance.
The what?
The pose that girl is in. I forget her name, but the monster girl there. That's the Caesar Zeppeli pose. From Battle Tendency from Part 2.
Yeah, it's the from the second season, yeah.
Yeah. And the one next to him, is that also somebody doing a pose, or is that someone just reacting?
No, it's...
Oh, I see. Look,
I'm doing.
Great. You know what I was watching the other day? I was watching the movie Pumping Iron with Schwarzenegger. Oh, documentary. And it's funny because in the film, the bodybuilders, one of the big part of their whole routine about winning contests is the posing. The posing is very important. And as I was watching them, and they were talking about, like, they were going into, it's actually kind of a really detailed process about figuring out which poses are the best for showing off your anatomy and your symmetry as a bodybuilder, and, you know, they're practicing them, and they're, you know, going through their routines and stuff. I realized that Araki, who created JoJo, he was doing something along those lines. I mean, he was coming up with crazier new poses, but I think he was thinking about that stuff as something as a masculine thing, which is really strange. Brian Echo, holy shit. Let me mute and unmute. Maybe that'll help. I'm not sure. All right. There was something else I saw earlier that somebody made in comments. Oh, yeah. Somebody says, do a Badger Chan and a Vivian James lewd. Have them kissing. Well, I will consider that. I'm going to mute this for a second. All right. Oops. Trying to have multiple things open at once. South America is load. Share the load. Jeffrey Hughes, are we still getting thank you. We were getting an echo earlier. Looks like this is good. This is very immature. All these badgers and no mushrooms. I don't know what to tell you. Bodybuilding is bodybuilding shows are a male beauty pageant. I was looking at that stuff and it was pretty impressive, man. I gotta tell you, I am sorely tempted to get a weight set, and there was one guy that was on there that was one of the contestants, and of course this is from 1975. I'm not saying they didn't use steroids back then, but I don't think that I don't think the culture of bodybuilding was the same. You know, there was a guy that was competing. That was like in his 40s. He was like 45 or something, you know. And I was like, "Holy shit, man! That guy looks amazing for that age." So I think that actually a lot of those guys were older. That's pretty inspiring. And then I don't know if you guys are you know, look at or care about our Schwarzenegger's YouTube channel, but you can you know, he has a YouTube channel and you can look at. He has videos where he sort of reacquaints himself with people that he knew from his bodybuilding days, and you know, they're in their 60s and they're still going to the gym and they're still working out. That's pretty cool, I gotta say.
Wonder, you know what he should do? He should make a few of these prank videos where he just goes around slapping women's asses like he used to.
Prank videos? Schwarzenegger?
Yeah.
He got away with it back then.
Yeah, slapping women's asses, grabbing their asses, all that stuff.
All of them.
Yeah, I mean, if you want to see, he's funny as fuck. If you watch Pumping Iron, when he talks about his ideal woman, he's super candid and honest about it. But at the same time, he's funny because he's just like big ass, little ass, big titties, little titties, like, you know, what he likes. I don't care. As long as they have good personality and
they have
to be around and they can hold a conversation. Was that? I thought Koo was saying something. I guess not.
Yep. Just don't care.
Doesn't matter to me.
I like boobs. Boobs are good.
Boobs are good.
What type of boobs do you like?
Natural?
Chesty ones. The ones that stick on the like back or the head are just fucking weird.
Yeah.
Head boobs. That needs to be done.
Yeah. I think for myself, I'm one of the strange guys who are like, I don't mind tiny titties.
How strange.
Yeah.
Frickin' weird. Now you can.
Tiny titties, or give me the big fake ones.
See, no, I don't. I'm not crazy about the fake ones. I think that if it comes down to either small real ones or big fake ones, I'd rather have small real ones.
Yeah.
And that goes for asses too. I've seen some fake asses, and they look gross.
Oh yeah. Ugh.
Although there's that operation where they can remove fat from different places on their body and inject it into their arse and breasts and stuff.
Yeah.
Have you seen that?
No, I've never seen that. There's actually a porn star that did that. Was she Layla Starr, maybe? I don't know. She was like really thin in the beginning of her career, and then like the ass thing became big, so to keep up, she got like butt injections. Well, I could be wrong. I don't know. I remember hearing about that a while back.
I know Brazil has had a big problem with butt injections and all that stuff.
Do they?
Yeah.
You'd think
there's
that was just natural shit over there.
No, there's a lot of backdoor dealings where women are getting ass injections.
Wow, there's a lot
and
of
some are
backdoor dealings. I like that.
There's a lot of backdoor deals that deal with the backdoor.
I bet that was.
If you know what I mean. But Jose, you were saying?
Yeah. So, yeah, just they're having a big problem with it because so many women are doing it not through legitimate doctors, and there's like massive amount of medical issues and things, and I think a couple of women have actually died from it.
Damn.
Yeah.
Well, they never go ask them out for some.
Yeah. I mean, just do squats, bro.
Squats, lunges.
Yeah. What's the one where you're like taking a step forward and you lean into it?
Mm-hmm. Or the where you kind of do like a push-up pose and then you gotta kick your knees up to your chest type thing.
Oh yeah,
those are just so freaking difficult.
If you want to start bodybuilding, you should look at P90X.
Yeah, P90X.
Yes. Pretty intense, but yeah, pretty good.
Yeah, I actually have a friend who does that. I should ask him how he likes it. I don't know, man. There's so many fads, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm just like...
It was referred to me from a friend who actually does bodybuilding. So. That's kind of where I got my information from. I don't know if that's more legitimate or less legitimate. It can't be less legitimate.
How are the girls in Spain, Ku?
Hmm?
How are the girls in Spain? Are they hot? Are they like...
Oh, wow.
I remember, I don't know, maybe it's just like something about going to another country, but when I went to Canada the first time, I was like, there's a lot of hot chicks over here in Canada. And then when I went to BC, I said the same thing. I was like, wow, there's a lot of like really fit women here.
Well, but, you came to Vancouver, right?
Yeah.
And yeah, Vancouver, it's a very outdoorsy city, so a lot of people like to be a bit more fit and stuff around here.
Yeah.
So, yeah, there's quite a few hot women. Just even walking around the city, I'm just like, God damn! I'm just going to stare. Screw it. I'm just going to stare.
Brian, it's the yoga pants. Yeah, I think so. But we have yoga pants here in Chicago. It really just comes down to... It just comes down to what part of the city you're in, because people have visited Chicago from somewhere else and they've said there's a lot of hot women here too. So it's not really like limited to a specific location. It just comes down to, that was one of the things I realized. It just comes down to, you know, like maybe the climate. Like if you went to Florida Beach, you'd probably see, and I don't mean like the one that all the old Jewish people live at. You'd like see some attractive women because it's like close to the Caribbean islands and, you know, it's really hot. But it just comes down to like location. Someone said Iran does a roaming trade in plastic surgery as well, as they have great looking women in Iran, and all they want to do is look like goddamn Barbie.
Like that one Russian lady who's trying to look like Barbie?
Jesus.
Yeah, I was thinking about that one. Crazy.
Yeah, no, that's nuts. And it's like, I like how the clickbait sites, they like that's some new shit. This chick is trying to look like a doll. Look here for more. It's like, yeah, we know. It's an old story now. I'm going to go for another 5 minutes. And then we'll call the stream. But I want to thank you guys for coming out. And those of you guys who are watching.
Okay, thanks for letting me on.
Yeah?
I could have done anything.
Well, hopefully you guys will come back when I'm coming back on again.
Yeah.
Badger-chan has that smile because she is a yandere. I don't know. I just wanted to put a goofy smile on her face. I was actually thinking about having a tongue come out, too, but I don't know yet. I might do that, actually. There you go. Let's see. Will we see the finished animation of Anita's mom? That's not Anita's mom. That's just a
fan. Nope. It's not Anita's mom.
It's just a member of the collective.
Yeah, and if you want to see it, you're going to have to wait a fair while. And, yeah, just keep tuning in to Honey Badger Radio.
Mm-hmm.
And all the great stuff that we're going to be having for you. Woohoo! Plug.
That was so shameless.
Shameless plug.
Isn't that what we're doing now? We're trying to be shameless and feature in every goddamn show.
Supposed to be artists being artists. Don't tell them about the plugs.
Artists have to be man whores, or woman whores, as the case may be.
Just whores in general.
Just so happens there's more men here. I think that we may have a sex gap in the number of artists working in art streams.
Misogynist.
We have to close the gap. Somebody get bell hooks on the phone. Like, get this fixed.
50% of women who can't draw at all.
It's funny. It's funny because obviously there are women artists, but it seems like when I try to get people who are willing to work with us or do animation or even write things, the majority of people that are contributors that we get are men. And even though Honey Badger Radio is headed by women, and that's actually the main sort of crux of what it is, or at least that's how it came into being, still a lot of men in it. We just they can't have anything before we come along and take it away.
It would be nice to see some girls in the stream drawing some dudes and stuff, I guess.
Oh, absolutely. I wouldn't mind that. You know who I'd like to get on to do this? Oh, first off, I'm getting Terrell Hunt next time. Do you guys know who that is? He did Goblins. Yeah, the Goblins guy. I'm going to try and get him on in our stream. I offered him to come on this week, but he has a trip where he's out of town, so he's not going to be around for 2 weeks. But that'll be the time that I do the next stream, so that might work out. And so he'll probably be on, and then I'd like to get I'd like to get the girl who does pleb comics. Do you know who that is? I'd like to get her on, but I don't know. Like, she seems to be hard to reach.
She was fired from her job.
What was that?
She was fired from her job by some social justice warriors.
Yes, she was. She was fired from her job, but then I think she got her job back. Oh. I think that everything worked out.
That's great.
So, but like, I'd like to try to get her on. So maybe if anybody who's watching. Or any of you guys who are in the chat here, if you think that you might be able to reach her, I've been trying, but I don't think she knows me, and that's fine. If any of you guys can reach her and be like, hey, would you like to come on for an art stream? You don't even have to. She doesn't even have to talk much. You can just respond. I know for a lot of people, it's about social stuff. Like they have issues talking to people. But I'd like to have her on because I'd like to see her process. I like to see people's processes. Actually, that reminds me. I want to ask you guys a couple of technical questions. So this is my Badger Chan. I'm going to apply some colors to her face a little bit here. But Ku, when you do your shading, which is cell shading, do you create masks or do it a certain way, or do you just put it all in the same layer? How do you typically approach it?
I use some masks. I do a folder for all the different colors. And I use a mask for whatever. For the form of everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then I do another layer for the shadows and stuff.
You do a multiply layer?
Yeah.
So you do a multiply layer, and then what color do you normally put? Is it like a gray, or do you apply like a darker version of the same color, or just the same color?
It depends on the kind of drawing, but Since I do a lot of hentai, I use a kind of red-gray color.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. I think that, that looks good. I like that. I want to do some cell shading on my work. But I know there's different ways. I normally put a color, like a base color of what it really is, and I make a layer on top of it, and I mask it to the layer that has color. And I'll do a certain section, so I might just do skin on one layer, clothes on a layer, hair on its own layer, things like that, and then I'll make a mask, and then I'll do a color that is slightly darker and slightly, like, move it on the color wheel either a little to the left or a little to the right, so it's a little bit analogous. So if it's red hair, I might go to red-orange, or I might go to red-violet, depending on whether it's a shadow or closer to a highlight, or whether the light, you know, I want the shadow to be cool or warm, although usually they're cool. So, but it can take a while, but that's how I like to do it. And Eduardo, you have a really cool, like, painterly kind of style. When you do your shadows, do you just do everything on the same layer and just keep adding, or do you have a way that you like to blend?
I use the same layer mostly because I use a lot of this tool, the finger tool, and I have and I like to blend all the colors into the mix that you do. So yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I see that what you're doing now with the Sargon faces, you're painting everything gray.
Yeah.
And then after that, do you, like, then you put a layer of color on top?
No, I normally use the curves. I don't know who's having in English.
It's in Spanish.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know what that is. What is it in Spanish? Maybe Ku knows the English word.
It's curves.
The English word for what?
This tool I'm using.
Curves, yeah.
Oh, curves.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And I use the colors here too. Oh. Yeah. I can use also color layer on top to get some.
Very cool. All right, I dig it. That looks really good. And is that a layer that's just like on top at a lower opacity, maybe a blending mode? Oh, use color.
Yes.
So you can just paint. When you paint it, it changes the color.
Overlay and color are the ones that I use the most. And I use control everything with the opacity.
Oh, yeah, that's good. That's cool. Daniel, you stopped sharing.
Yeah, just one second. I just wanted to show people what I finished up last time.
Oh, okay. Okay, and this is done in the same program, correct?
It was done in ArtRage, yeah.
All right, and so when you, because I see you have some shading and stuff going on too, what is your general approach? You put everything on one layer, or how do you...
Usually I got my rough layer, and then I have like an inking layer, and then I got my different colors and stuff, like one for the skin, one for the hair, one for the clothes, all that type of stuff, and one for the background. So if I take this away, that's not working. Yeah. But yeah, it's I just like to do as many layers as possible so that I don't really confuse myself too much.
Yeah. No, it looks good. I like that. Who is that supposed to be? Just some girl who likes showing her underboob?
Yeah. Basically.
And Corvus? Oh, she's magic sword. What? What's that? Particles.
Particles, yes, yes. Do some particles.
Is that the sword of truth? The sword of facts? Online harassment?
Yes. The sword of badger.
Well, looks good. And when you do your colors, do you work in a similar way, like your method of shading and stuff? You separate everything a lot. I see a lot of layers already.
Yeah, I have like stupid amounts of layers. I can never be bothered to name them. So yeah, I just end up with a bunch of layers, often poking through trying to find ones. I separate everything, and I guess depending on what looks better, I can either like color, like shade the object itself with the layer, or use a blending effect.
Oh, that looks good. All right. Let me, I think I'm going to go ahead and wrap it up. Again, I want to thank you guys for joining me on the art stream. And, yeah, I mean, that's just all. You see that I like to see the Honey Badger brand be expressed in so many different ways. So, thanks to you guys for coming out, and thanks to you guys for coming and joining us on the stream today. And yeah, that's it. I mean, I guess, you know, like I said before, if you guys find a way to like reach out to Pleb Comics, let me know, because I'd like to bring her on. And maybe you can just find the best way to reach her. And I'll do it myself. And for those of you who just, you know, have any comments, or if you want to send us some art or whatever via email, do so. And you know what I'll do is on the next show, I'll show some pictures of fan art that people have made of the Honey Badgers, of Badger Chan, of whatever. I know that some people who have sent me some things already, so maybe I'll show some of those on the next stream. Thanks again for joining us, and I want to thank Ku, Eduardo, Daniel, and Corvus for taking the time to join me on the stream, and I'll talk to you guys next time.